You're listening to The Dental Guys, episode 59, Geek's Corner Takes Over. Sometimes a dental journal comes along with articles that we just can't ignore, and the latest issue of JOMI was just that kind of journal. Jon and Wes dissect two articles with very important consequences for the restorative dentist and the implant surgeon that will immediately change the way you think about implants. Short implants, leaky implant connections, rants, and racing drones all in one show. It's time to embrace your inner nerd this week on The Dental Guys. This episode of The Dental Guys is brought to you by the Dental Crafters Network, your implant restorative connection. From surgical planning to patient-specific guides, quality implants, and final restorations, the Dental Crafters Network provides one relationship with infinite possibilities. Call 1-800-472-8302 today. That's 1-800-472-8302. And welcome to this week's episode of The Dental Guys. I'm Jon, The Dental Guy.
And I'm Wes, The Dental Guy.
And Wes, I don't know if you noticed, but
I did.
I made some upgrades to the studio.
Man.
I got a little hashtag going on back there. And also a little quick shout out to Michael for my La Croix. He noticed that. Nice. I was always drinking this on, and he actually sent me La Croix. So fan mail.
Very nice.
La Croix. Anyway, we used to call it La Croix. But anyway, so.
But.
And also there's a Millennium Falcon back there. You see that?
I see
framed
that.
Framed Millennium Falcon, like the blueprints. So, I mean, I've been working on the place. I'm still got some, I got big plans, but I mean, you know, I just want to make sure you notice that.
Jon, it's the first thing I pointed out to you, but I'm going to one-up you tonight. I'm going to one-up you in a big way. So I'm going to take my headphones off here, and if you're turning, if you're just pull the lawnmower over in the middle of the winter, pull the car off the road, take
this
the skis off.
This is about to be
off,
some must-see TV.
I'm going to take my headphones off, and like, we're going to must-see, you're going to need to must-see this.
Oh, man. Whenever Wes takes the headphones off, you know, what? Okay, Wes is wearing some like spaceman goggles right now. Hold on. I'm just going to listen. I hear something. Something just flew by. Was that? What was that? Are you flying a drone? Are you flying with those goggles?
Jon. FPV drones are here, and Wes the Dental Guy.
So did you have like the best Christmas ever?
Best birthday, best Christmas ever.
So you can fly the drone with your goggles?
Yeah, man. So it's amazing. So first person view, these are racing goggles. They have...
Like I've seen on TV where the guys race the drones.
That's right.
While
the exact same brand they use, and that was just a little indoor drone that you can pick up at your local hobby store. But the wife came through in a big way for the 40th birthday. Yes, 40, Jon, 40.
Oh, I didn't say that. I didn't know if you're
gonna
bring that up.
I can let it out. I mean, I'm comfortable.
Yeah, you look great. You look great for 40.
Yeah, the Botox looks good. So so I'm not afraid.
Okay.
Here's the thing is that drones and quadcopters. I mean, the one that I've built and it had to solder and all these things, it's amazing. It's amazing. The thing, I think I sent you the video of how fast this thing flies, but I mean, it'll go over 80 miles an hour. And it's unbelievable. Unbelievable.
You just don't shoot your eye out, man. That's all I'm going to say.
That's
with hilarious. Christmas being on our minds.
And it's going to be Christmas all year.
Well,
for me.
I mean, I'm going to have to really up my game on the studio because now you got drones and goggles. I mean, I'll work on it.
Right.
Well, today's show is a different show than what we've done in a while because we're going to do an entire show that is a Geek's Corner show. Now, before you who are like, oh, research. Ugh. Well, first of all, you're probably not listening to our show if you think research doesn't matter. But you guys know we talk a lot about journals. And the most recent issue of International Journal of Oral and Maxillofacial Implants came out. We're going to be diving into that today. But before we do that, we have some pretty important news that we want to share with you guys. If you've been watching the show, the last episode that you saw was the launch of restorative driven implants. And we're pretty excited about that. You know, that's been a long time coming, to say the least, Wes. I mean, we've been working on that forever.
Yeah.
And here it is. It's there. The website is live, restorativedrivenimplants.com. We've been asked to teach the dental guys, along with some of our close friends, some really talented people, lab technicians, surgeons, an implant series. And it's done the way the dental guys do stuff, which is, it's going to be done right. We're not going to be just throwing people in there, right? I mean, we're going to be teaching you the research, just like this show. I mean, we start with research. We start with why. We start with what we're doing and why. And Wes, I mean, this is going to be pretty epic.
Listen, if you're looking for a great place to learn dental implant therapy, comprehensive learn, or first of all, understand dental implants. I like what we've said there. Understand, place, restore, and then implement dental implant therapy. Mm-hmm. Restorative driven implants is where it's at. And so what we're doing as the dental guys is we've been asked to help kind of coordinate the educational experience and to make this just second to none. It's 60 hours of credits over a 3-weekend time period. You're going to have 8 hours of online module education, John. So it means you're going to start some of that learning at your home, watching Wes, the dental guy, teach you about dental implants. And then John and I will be in live lecture format, too, doing hands-on procedures. And then a third weekend, which is what it's all about, is about taking 2 days and doing the surgical implementation. Bring your assistant, because my assistant of 8 years will be there teaching two of your team members the ins and outs behind the scenes of what goes on in your office when it comes to implant dentistry. And then the third half day there in the North Woods in Wisconsin at a great location. We're going to have Todd Haley teaching implementation. What? Who know better than that? Who owns and has implemented dental implants in many, many practices over the years?
Yeah. And so you can take not only the research based knowledge, how to do basic surgery, how to choose cases, and then you'll actually get to do those cases. You'll get to place your own implants.
Yeah.
Each participant will have over the shoulder guidance from mentors who will be experienced implant surgeons and restorative docs.
Yep.
We'll have a whole lecture on restorative, not just on surgery, but how to treatment plan from the crown down, how to place, thinking about your restoration, and then implementation. It's going to be pretty amazing.
Yeah, where can they go, John, to sign up or find out more?
Yeah, restorativedrivenimplants.com. And really, everything is there. You know, you've got all the information. You can sign up there. There's also a phone number you can call where you can get more info directly from us. So, you know, if you guys want to get involved with that, head over to restorativedrivenimplants.com. Check out what we have to offer. We're pretty excited about it. We also have another, we've talked about this several times, the Voices of Dentistry Conference. This is probably the last show that we'll have before we're live at the Voices of Dentistry Conference. And it is going to be an amazing meeting. We know the lineup. We're not going to we're not going to spoil all the secrets that are going to happen during the time we're there, but there's going to be some amazing stuff going on. We're going to have some amazing people on the show. And Wes, we're going to be doing some live streaming during the show, which is something that we've been working up toward. We've got all of our gear ready for that, and it's going to be pretty awesome.
Listen, I'm super pumped to bring Kittenbach on board, and they'll be providing, they'll be sponsoring the dental guys live stream from the Voices of Dentistry, sponsored by Kittenbach, and we're super pumped to bring them on board, and proud to say that the dental guys are excited about also Jeff Roush from Spear Education will be live streaming Friday at 9:40 a.m. That's Friday the 26th, 9:40 a.m.
Phoenix time.
Phoenix time. So mark your calendars, 9:40 a.m. You can check us out on Facebook Live, and you're going to hear Jeff Spear, Jeff Roush of Spear Education talk about the orthodontist role in sleep medicine. Now, John, this is going to be so good.
Oh, man.
Because he's going to bring it.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of the top speakers in airway and sleep medicine, and associated course with Spear Education, lots of other good organizations. And he does it right, and we've got some tough questions for him, some good questions that I think will really you know, get right to his wheelhouse as far as what we need to be doing right now in airway and sleep medicine, and some of the challenges we're facing right now with implementation of sleep medicine among our dental, in the dental world. And so you're really going to be on the cutting edge here, talking about dental sleep medicine. And there's lots of other people we've got lined up. So even if you can't be with us at Voices of Dentistry, which, you know, there's still maybe some room for you to sign up, but if you can't be there with us, at least you can tune in to live stream. And don't hold us to that exact time. I mean, we want it to be that exact time, but we will be posting updates on Facebook and Twitter and letting you guys know the exact time. But we think that's what we're shooting for if everything goes as planned. So we're pretty excited about that. And, you know, right along with, again, we talk about what this show is about. And this, you know, today is a perfect example, again, of why we feel like we're able to teach something like restorative dentary implants. Because, again, you know, it's all about the basic science, which leads to our clinical everyday dentistry. And we strongly believe that the clinical dentistry that you do every single day should be based upon solid evidence base. And I know that that term gets worn out, but man, it is where it's at. So Wes, let's dive right into this. This was this journal. We got it. We both got it. And we both like sent messages to each other after we read it. We go, oh my goodness, this thing is full of amazing, amazing articles.
Listen, the first thing that you look for in dental implant research is, or any research really, John, is these long-term studies.
And that's what you always want to see.
And whenever we've seen this in JOMI, this is in 2017, Journal of Oromaxillofacial Implants, the success and failure rates, now get this, of 1,344 implants, but not only just implants, we're talking 6 millimeters to 9 millimeter implants. Now, the longest study that I could find, or the most implants that I can find, was a MISH study of like 700 and some odd 6.5 millimeter implant bodies. And these were going to assess the success and stability of 6, 7, 8, and 9 millimeter long implants, short implants over the long haul. How long, John? From 60 to 229 months in function.
Yeah, like, I mean, whoa. I've seen some other studies, like you say, and, you know, like Frank Renoir is another guy who's done a lot of research on short implants, and he does have some long-term studies, and he does have some studies on large numbers, but this is one of the longest term, maybe the longest term, that is so comprehensive. You want to know what the state of the science currently is of short implant success. This is probably a good indication.
Yeah, let's just cut to the chase here, John.
Yeah.
The success rate, it's
overall cumulative success rate in this study, 98.8%.
98.8%. I mean, okay, first of all, why are we so excited about short implants? Well, the first thing short implants will do for us is that we should always look to short implants prior to considering grafting. If we can reduce morbidity of a procedure, we can reduce treatment time. Like patients, you know, I have a patient today, and she's going to require, there's no way that she can have a short implant, but she's going to have a sinus lift. Now, if you have to have a sinus lift, okay, you're going to have the sinus lift, and then you're going to have to wait 3 to 4 months. Some surgeons like to wait 6 months even. And depending on how large the sinus lift is, you know, depends on a lot of whole bunch of stuff. But if we can minimize sinus lifts, we can minimize treatment time and put short implants in.
And we know now that that's kind of the way that the things have shifted. You know, really in the last 2 or 3 years, as this research has been coming out, there's been a huge shift in the game with some of the key opinion leaders as the research has come out in favor of this, that we're starting to see that number. It doesn't mean that there's not times when you need to graft. If you've got a situation you need it, then absolutely it can be successful. You're going to have people that sometimes, you know, they hear that and they go, oh, well, I can get amazing bone regeneration, vertical augmentation. Great. We're really glad for you. We're really glad you can do that. And that's amazing. But we at least have to admit that maybe there are times where this could be a better thing. But of course, the question's always been, well, what's the long term? What's the long term? What's the long term? And when you see overall cumulative success rate of 98.8, and maybe even more surprising to me, they broke it out into the sizes. 190 of these were 6 millimeter implants, and cumulative success rate of 97.5% at a mean time of 109.2 months in function. So you know, roughly 8-9 years in function, and we've got that's a very long-term study of 6 millimeter implants. And most of them were 8s, 1,094, cumulative success rate of 98.9% at a mean time of about 10 years in function. So you look at this kind of study and you think, man, this was, I mean, can you get any more definitive, Wes? I mean, we talked about before that you start looking at a study when you have 1 year result. Oh, that's interesting, but that could be just a fluke. When you have 5-year results, it gets interesting. When you've got 10-year results, now you really can't argue.
Really, if you don't start turning your practice based on a 10-year study like this, you're really not practicing really good dentistry. I mean, I have to say it. I mean, if you're still doing, 14 and 15 and 16 millimeter implants in, you know, bone that is native. I mean, it's unless you're doing, you know, something like that's narrow, a narrow body implant or something like that. We know, based on research and force diagrams, that most of the force associated with occlusion on a dental implant happens within that first 5 millimeters, John. And this is why, really, it's important that when we choose a short implant. You know, we'll talk a little bit about connection later on in the show, but when you choose a short implant, that you choose a really good connection. Mm-hmm. And if that connection is not favorable for load transfer to the bone, then, you know, it's probably not a good short implant. Now, you know, I'm not, you know, I'm not an engineer or anything like that, but the conclusions to this study were pretty definitive in that if we place 6 millimeter implants, anything 6, 7, 8, or 9, we are safe to say that most of the time those are going to integrate. And I remember a study once, John, you and I talked about it. You might be able to quote it, but it talked about that if we do have failures with short implants, they're going to happen in a very short period of time within the first months of placement. And it's interesting here that one implant failed for no discernible reason in the 84 to 95 month time period in function. And so they don't even know why that happened. So it's very rare to see a long-term failure.
Late
failures with these dental implants.
Yeah, I thought too, you know, a couple of things that I got out of this, or that both of us did as we were talking about this, is the exclusion criteria for the patients that he... Because this was all done basically by one person, Paul Fugazzotto. And he, private practice guy, been around a long time, been involved in research a long time. And it was interesting to see the exclusion criteria. So he did not, he excluded patients who had patients who were unwilling to undergo comprehensive dental therapy, including management of parafunction. So people that were wearing their teeth but would not get treated for it. uncontrolled periodontal disease,
yep,
history of persistent sinus infections, a smoking habit of greater than 10 cigarettes per day,
yep,
or unwillingness to commit to the long-term post-active therapy maintenance program.
But John,
and also uncontrolled diabetes.
Here's the thing, is that you and I talked about this. When I saw this, I was like, John, I said, isn't this our protocol for choosing patients for our own treatment and for treatment? If we see patients, if John and I, as general dentists, that are, we are current placers, we've been placing for a long, I've been placing for a long time, John's been placing for a couple years now. But John, when you and I first sit down and when you and I were talking about you getting involved with dental implants, I was like, dude, why would you even choose anything that's outside these protocols right here on this study?
Yeah.
There's no reason to.
This is the kind of thing that you say, well, these are the patients that most of us will be treating. And of course, you can, I think, find exceptions to every rule. If you were to look at the worst possible patient, you're going to see higher failures. We know that. But this is a pretty reasonable exclusion criteria, I think. And also, I thought interesting, all implants were restored with individual abutments and crowns. No splinting.
No splinting.
That's something that had also been
discussed. Does occlusion matter?
Right. It all brings that back.
Do we need to splint posterior implants?
Right, because, you know, you go back to old Carl Misch, you know, rest in peace, Carl, had talked a lot about this early on, thinking that from a biomechanical standpoint, that splinting would be necessary with implants. And
last year at the Voices of Dentistry, we challenged that occlusion does not matter with implants. It does not cause implant failure. You know,
and we know that at this point, I think we've kind of settled that, you know, there is not really such a thing as overloading. And I mean, if there is, then here we are. You know, I think 1,344 implants would suggest that even short unsplinted implants in the maxilla, because most of these were done in sinus, internal sinus lift sites. So these were many times, these were an osteotome sinus augmentation with simultaneous implant placement.
That's right.
So not, these were not necessarily abundant bone cases.
This you know, wasn't what he said is easy.
All treated sites, all treated sites presented with between 4 and 6 millimeters of residual bone crustal to the floor of the sinus. So most of these were in at least some augmented bone, some of them in a significant amount of augmented bone with a transalveolar sinus augmentation. So this is not an abundant bone situation. We're, if anything, again, anybody that's got their complaints or their concerns about short implants, what is it? Okay, occlusal overload. Come on. It's obviously not an issue, guys.
Right.
What about maxillary grafted bone? It's obviously not an issue, guys. You know, what about an unsplinted? It's obviously not an issue, guys.
I challenge people right now.
Yeah.
It's not just it's not just about the short implants.
Mm-hmm.
It's about dental implants as a whole. If we're going to see failures because of occlusion, of mechanics, it's going to happen in short implants.
Right.
It's going to happen
the
there because those
compromised site those should the, be the most compromised.
It's the most compromised situation. A short implant is the thing. So I mean, like, here's the thing. If you place short implants and you get 1 to 2 millimeters of bone loss, that's not a good thing, you know, because if you lose 1 millimeter of bone on a 6 millimeter implant, that's 15%, you know?
Yep.
And so that's a lot. And we know, as what you and I've studied and what we've talked about on the show, is that we shouldn't see bone loss. Mm-hmm. We should actually see bone growth, bone maturation, soft tissue maturation. I was looking back at some of my post-op x-rays that are 8 and 9 years old, and it's as if bone is growing. It is crazy when you place with spec to tissue and do it right.
This study helps us to put to rest.
Yeah.
Not that we were doubting this, but you know, this study, once again, I don't know that you can, if somebody out there still after reading this says short implants are a concern, you know, I don't know what to tell you. I think that it's pretty clear that's not a concern. And I would definitely say, this is an article that you need to have in your Dropbox. You know, if you keep a folder of Geek articles like we do, this is one to pull out if you're having a discussion about short implants with your surgeon. If you're a restorative doc and you're maybe wanting your surgeon to consider placing short implants, I think that's one thing that we should maybe just mention, like from a practical aspect with this, you know, you might want to consider here, if you're a restorative doc and you're listening to this right now and you're not an implant placer, that's totally fine. Do what you feel most comfortable with. If you're you're thinking, well, this sounds great, but because I've got lots of, you might be saying to yourself, I've got lots of patients who I think could benefit from short implants, but my surgeon doesn't place short implants, and maybe you don't even know why. I would encourage you, print this article out. If you send us a message, we can give it to you. We can't post it online, obviously, but we'll send it to you if you ask us for it. Or subscribe to JOMI, for goodness sakes. But anyway, and bring it over, have lunch with your surgeon.
Yeah.
And just say, hey, you know, I want you to take a look at this, or email it to them and say, hey, let's talk about this. And see what they have to say, because this can really change your practice as a restorative dentist.
It's a practice changer.
Yeah, you can tell your patient, instead of saying, we're going to graft, come back in, you know, several months, place a longer implant, hopefully everything will work. Sinus grafts are a lot, you know, more involved, especially trying to do mandibular vertical augmentation, very involved. And this now gives you some ammunition where you can talk to your surgeon and maybe have them look into this, because I think this is definitely a game changer, like Wes said. And Wes, I think we need to give a shout out to one of our listeners that just while we're on this topic, right?
Yeah, I just want to say a shout out, because I was getting ready for the show and I got a text, actually a Facebook message from one of our listeners, Gregory. Gregory, you know who you are. I won't say your last name, but he sent me an x-ray of his first shorty that he placed today. And he's super pumped about it. He was asking how it looked on the x-ray. Of course, it looked fantastic. He did a great job. And he was one of the early people that I got involved with in training how to place dental implants. And from what I understand, he's doing it right. He's asking the right questions. And that's awesome. So shout out to Gregory for placing shorts. And he placed it right up against the sinus there in area 3. It looks like it's going to be a great restoration heading forward for that patient. So good job, Gregory. So, you know, if you have a surgeon or if you have a friend that's a placer or somebody that's placing implants in your practice, but they don't have a good short implant, hey, look no other than the Dental Crafters Network, because Argon Dental Implants, argondentalusa.com, they have, if you scroll down on their website to products and you click on K3 Pro Short, they have an FDA-cleared K3 Pro Short. This short implant comes in 5.5 length, 6.5 length, and 7.5 length. And the available diameters are anything from a 4-millimeter diameter all the way up to 6 millimeters in diameter. So a wide body there. What's great about this is it's the same connection whether you go from the 4 in diameter all the way up to the 6. Fantastic implant. It has an internal conical connection. It's a deep connection, and it has an anti-rotational hex at the bottom of that deep connection for self-orienting your prosthetics and those type of things. But John, I think this is a great implant. I think that we're excited that the Dental Crafters Network is carrying this line of dental implants for you to buy. And we're placers of this dental implant. I mean, we've seen some fantastic success.
It's a great implant. You know, we talked about earlier with regard to that study that, you know, if you're going to be placing short implants, we talked about this in a previous episode, it's not for the faint of heart. It's not necessarily easy to place short implants. And we're not necessarily saying that shorter means easier. In fact, often these are placed in very compromised cases and very compromised situations. So we're not advocating that you just go out there and start placing short implants if you don't know what you're doing. But what we would say is, when you're ready for a short implant, what you need is you need one with an excellent connection. We just mentioned the fact that, you know, you want to have long-term success with your shorties, because it's so much more critical that you have that long-term success when you're talking about short implants, because 1 millimeter, 2 millimeters of bone loss, that's such a big deal in these short implants. And that's one of the reasons why surgical technique matters, but also we think that the implant type matters. And so when you're talking about what can you do to get the most predictable results. We think that using an implant from a company like Argon will give you that. And if you, our next paper that we're going to be going into is all about this this connection question. And we think that not only does Argon have a very good surface, and they have just excellent support behind the implant, excellent design, but we think that the connection is maybe the key, possibly, to some long-term success when it comes to a short implant in a lot of high occlusal load situations, which many of these are under. You gotta have a great implant behind you. So as Wes said, ArgonDentalUSA.com. You can also call the Dental Crafters Network as well. And you can call them 1-800-472-8302. They'll be able to put you in touch with the implant reps from Argon K3. And once again, we thank the Dental Crafters Network for being a sponsor of the show.
I'll never forget the day, John, that mom and her daughter showed up in my practice for a consultation for my periodontist. And she had already been through implant surgery in areas 7 and 10, had the implants removed by my periodontist. She had been to a surgeon, and this surgeon had placed these dental implants, and they had already seen marginal bone loss. And the gray was already showing through the tissue. Now, this is prior to them being restored even. They weren't even loaded yet. And the oral surgeon told the mom and said this, said, well, the bone will grow back and on the facial there.
Interesting.
Of 7 and 10. And this is early after implant placement. So the mom, being as smart as she was, and I'm glad she was smart, she began doing some digging, and she got a second opinion from one of the my old mentors, and he educated her and encouraged her, and they had the implants removed. In fact, he told me whenever he laid the flap to remove 7 and 10 is basically they fell out in his hand. Clinicians, the very first part of this next study that we're going to go over is the biological consequences. Is that right, John?
That's right. Yeah, we're going to be talking about another study from the same issue, the November-December JOMI implant abutment connections.
Yeah.
A review of the biologic consequences and peri-implantitis implications. And this is done by Dave Cochran, who's a big name of University of Texas at San Antonio. Great school.
Great research.
Great departments there, their PROS department, as well as their perio and their oral surgery department. Puts out some, and this is, to me, a kind of another landmark article, which really, I mean, some of this is a summary of what we know up till now, I think, but some of it also builds on that by talking about what some of the more recent studies say about what leads to biologic stability or instability of implants, and then maybe what we know about how that affects peri-implantitis. And how does the host immune response react to these different implant designs? And basically, they go through the history of implant design. Now, not the entire history, but they go through the history of the types of connections, and they kind of break it down into three. They talk about butt joint connections, which would be the kind of connection that you would have from a kind of a classic Zimmer or Brandemark style implant.
And that could be internal or external, John.
Correct. Anything that where there's
like an internal hex or an external hex.
Yeah, flat to flat type of connection where there's no, there's no offset, there's no platform shift. And then they talk about having a no interface type of implant, which would be a tissue level implant. In other words, you've got the crown and abutment connection away from the bone up into the tissue area. And then you've got your bone level implant with a platform switched type of connection. And they really go through a lot of research that's been published over the years about butt joint connections. Because I think that's where they start with this whole thing, Wes, is they talk about, well, why does bone loss occur around butt joint implants versus like a tissue level implant? Because you can really see the difference between the two with bone loss. And it all comes down to the micro gap. And some of you, this is a review, but we know that bone loss starts from the point where the abutment is connected to the implant body. That's where bacteria go and hang out. That's where the inflammatory response starts. And from that point, historically, there's been about 1.5 millimeters of bone loss as a result of the micro gap and kind of the formation, as we've talked about many times on the show, of sort of a biologic width.
Mm-hmm.
In a tissue level implant where the crown to abutment connection is up above the tissue, away from the bone, you're more than 1.5 millimeters away from the bone. Like you think of the old Straumann tissue level. I mean, still round, still a good implant. And there's a polished collar that's 1 millimeter or so tall. So you know that you automatically are going to be about that far away from the bone. And they don't really have bone loss around those implants.
Right.
And the reason is there's no micro gap at the bone.
That's right.
But on these butt joint implants, Wes, you and I have both seen that when you put a flat-to-flat type of connection at the bone level,
mm-hmm.
that you tend to see bone loss to the first thread, cupping, yeah. or whatever you want to call it. The three-eye effect, if you want to call it.
Whoa. That's awesome. Can't believe it.
Oh, goodness. No,
you did.
I shouldn't
you
say
went
three
there.
Eye. But,
it
you know, Zimmer is the typical kind of prototype, I think, these days.
Yeah.
I think Zimmer, I would say, is the most prototypical flat-to-flat type of connection implant. And then they contrast that with platform shift. And that's why I shouldn't say 3i, because they do have a platform shift. And, you know, we know that if you have a platform shifted implant, and credit, honestly, goes to Lazzaro, Rich Lazzaro, one of the people who first developed platform switch connections and, of course, went on to develop the 3i implant.
Right.
And found that, strangely, they were having preservation of margin of bone better around a wider diameter implant with a standard diameter restorative component.
Right.
And it was actually a coincidence.
Yes. Because
that's crazy to me that they just messed up. They just didn't have the right size, so they just put on the wrong size and then found out that was causing less bone loss, and they didn't see that. Now, Cochran, the guy who wrote the article, one of the guys who wrote the article, he was one of the early kind of pioneers in this research as to why back in the late 2000s, and he was researching why this was happening and found kind of confirmed on the histology level that only minor bone loss was being observed around platform switching.
Right.
And Wes, tell us about that. Tell us why are we seeing, or at least theoretically, why are we seeing less bone loss around a platform-shifted implant compared to a butt joint?
Well, so it's all about biology. And any time that you introduce a dental implant into your jawbone, you are not just putting it in a solid piece of wood. You're putting it into something that has a blood supply. And when you move the part that actually is not fit perfectly, now, there's not any, you know, there it is proven that there is a micro gap no matter what kind of implant you have. Okay.
Right. There's no such thing as a cold weld.
There's no such thing as a cold weld. There will be a micro gap on a two-piece dental implant system. Now, some have less and some have more. And the ones that have more, you better use a platform shift on those. Now, what that platform shift does is it allows for more blood supply. Now, what's in blood? Neutrophils, macrophages. And what do they do? They fight peri-implantitis, John. And these things, if we have more soft tissue around our dental implants, now listen to what we're saying here. If we have more soft tissue around our dental implants, especially around that connected area, and the thicker that is, the better off we're going to be, and we're going to see less marginal bone loss around our dental implants. Now,
right.
John, I'm quoting research right there. Because who is one of our favorite people to quote? Tomas.
Right. Linkovicius.
He says that no matter what, you better have at least 3 millimeters above two-piece implant interfaces. Mm-hmm. Okay? There's a reason why that one-piece dental implant systems work. And the one that John was talking about here essentially is a one-piece dental implant with a polished collar for the tissue, and then the connected part is above the tissue. So let's just call that a one-piece, because it is.
Yeah, exactly.
And then you've got one piece that actually have the abutment built into it that you actually have to grind down. And we all know the problems associated with that. We won't get into that. But if you can create an implant with a perfect connection, which is impossible because you couldn't get the two parts fit together, the manufacturing alone, would it be impossible. Mm-hmm. It would be awesome. But here's the kicker, is that what they did show in this study, John, is that they did show that we can, if we can minimize the micro gap, that mm-hmm. it could have some influence on this. Okay. Now, what about, you know, they talked about this micro gap opening up in these larger angled internally connected implants. So meaning like right. the internal degree of taper on an AstroTech implant is something like, what, 11 or 12 mm-hmm. degrees, right?
Right.
And so that's a pretty wide angle. Now, on let's totally contrast that to a true Moore's taper, Henry Morse, who set up and defined the tooling that we use in manufacturing process, that's just outside of what a true Morse taper is. But let's go opposite of that and just say like a Bicon or a K3 Pro implant. Those have 3 degrees. So you're going from 11 to 3. Now, right. that alone, what did that do, John?
Yeah, and they talked about how the smaller the angle, in other words, the longer the taper connection. In other words, what you're looking at here is you're putting a cone down within this internal connection, and basically the longer
it's that a cone inside cone, of a cone. It's like two glasses. If you've never seen this before, take two really good glasses, okay, mm-hmm. that you drink out of, and try putting them together.
Right.
It's very dangerous, by the way.
Because right.
they can you can break it.
Yeah, and when that, if you take two metal cones within cones and place them together, the smaller that taper is, the more intimately those will connect. And what they found in the studies that they cite in this Cochrane paper is that from a mechanical standpoint, the smaller the Morse taper-like angle is, the higher the stability of the connection. And they found that there were micro gaps that were different sizes with these different things, but the better connections did find that what they say here is the degree of taper in the least contaminated connection was the smallest,
right.
which is 5.6 degrees, compared with the other groups, which had more bacterial contamination of 11 to 13 degrees. And so to go back to kind of the big picture, we went from the butt joint type of implants. We talk about the tissue level one piece implant, and then we talk about platform shifted implants. But the early platform shifted implants were still did not have a very deep connection. So we had a platform shift, but it was still mm-hmm. essentially a flat to flat connection with not maybe the best stability. And then we went to the next step, which was looking at these cone type connections, and some companies, for lack of better terms, just kind of got lucky with that was how they had originally designed their connection. And now a lot of companies we see these days are following along with that and sort of copying that. And everyone now just about has a conical, quote unquote, connection or a platform shifted connection. But the taper of those are very, very different. The depth of those are very, very different. And according to at least some of these studies, which are more theoretical, we have to be fair, we haven't seen, 10-year, split mouth studies right. using one company versus the next. Right. So you really can't compare directly, but at least we can say that the potential is there of the deeper connections, the lower angle of taper, maybe having a better protection against bacteria. And as Wes said earlier, You're moving the micro gap inward, which means the bacteria are further from the bone. That's one theory, is that bacteria are just simply further from the bone.
Right.
The other theory is, as Wes said, that the simply soft tissue volume is increased. And I really think that we should agree more with that theory because of Linkovicius work. And they cite Linkovicius work in here, and they say,
well, he talks
specifically, he says the a recent comparative clinical study by Linkovicius concluded that in healed ridges, soft tissue thickness around platform switched implants. So listen to this. He's not just comparing, because a lot of people take the easy approach. They compare a butt joint implant against a platform shifted implant. And they say, see, look how much better the platform shift is. But Linkovicius did a harder study. He had platform switched implants already. And he put the same exact implant in thick tissue and thin tissue, both platform switched. And his conclusion was, well, what he showed was that in the thin tissue, marginal bone loss of 1.1 millimeters versus thick tissue, marginal bone loss of 0.2. So what his conclusion was, platform shifting in and of itself doesn't matter.
That's right.
His conclusion was it's about the soft tissue thickness, which lends more to the theory that it's about the blood supply and the soft tissue thickness and less about the bacteria. Because in that study, the bacteria would be in the same exact place.
But
it's more about where's the tissue.
But we all want to choose a dental implant that if, you know, if things just aren't right, or if our patient just, look, we're talking about peri-implantitis here and biological complications. We don't know how to treat peri-implantitis, so why not minimize it? Mm-hmm. And so basically, I think the author is trying to say, yes, we do need to have 3 millimeters of tissue above our implant interface because there is a concern, and Linkovicius showed that, but we also need to consider that maybe some of these manufacturers need to start considering what type of taper, and he really goes in, I said Henry Morse, but Stephen Morse, he really goes in and talks about the fact that some of these aren't true Morse tapers, and what is a true Morse taper, and what does that do? So what makes a true Morse taper, John, is defined by the angle that the tapered surface make relative to the longitudinal axis of the component by the mismatch angle between the male and female part. Okay? Whoa. Now, that's crazy.
That's heavy.
Morse taper was an angle defined by Stephen Morse, like we said earlier. I said Henry, but I meant Stephen again. For tools, was relatively with a small angle of, get this, John, 2 degrees. 2.5 degrees. Now, listen, here's the thing, is that there's no implant right now that has a 2-degree taper, okay, that I know of. Show me. If you do have one, that's cool. But the problem with that is the manufacturing process to create that taper and the components that fit together, that's a problem. Now, here's the kicker, is peri-implantitis. When we have parts that are moving and creating a bacterial 360-degree bacterial, basically cesspool, down inside your gums, listen, it's a problem. And they go into that on this article. And here's what they say, is that, listen, the infection that's going on down there, okay, is not good, okay? So one, it could lead to, if your body gets out of control, a true peri-implantitis. Okay, that'd be bad. Okay, if your body swings the other way. So this kind of goes a little bit against our thinking as what Al Berkinson said, which he kind of challenged whether peri-implantitis was even a thing. But if there's bacteria down there, John, you know, that's a bad deal. So the
and they talk about how the studies on tissue level, essentially one-piece implants, show that they're much more marginally stable
as far as bone levels
than a lot of our two-piece implants. I mean, for all the kind of the crap we give the old Straumann tissue level from because it can be an aesthetic nightmare.
It's an aesthetic nightmare. It's impractical, but it works.
But it also has some real advantages from a standpoint of stability because you're keeping that cesspool, as you said, in a cleansable region, which is far away from the bone.
Right.
And if you're basically going to admit that all of our connections leak to some extent, and you have an infection on there, what you want to do is you want to get the best connection you can have, because if there's a possibility that this is causing the result of bone loss. And I think we just have to reject the idea that 2 millimeters of bone loss, as they put in this paper, is so predictable that such bone loss is considered a success criteria for these implants. Essentially, it's like, yeah, what's success for a butt joint implant? 2 millimeters of bone loss. Yeah, that's fine. As long as it doesn't lose more than that, then that's considered just part of it. We should not accept that.
Jon and I, we've talked about this over the past 2.5-3 years, really longer than that, as our conversation has been ongoing for almost 5 years now, is does connection matter? Mm. Does connection matter? We think it does. Again, long term, we think there's an issue with connection and it could matter. So when you're choosing a dental implant, you want to minimize peri-implantitis. First of all, I think it starts with surgical protocols, tissue thickness, John. And then I think that we need to start looking at our implant design. I think we need to also be careful of non-OEM parts. Craig Mish mentioned on the stage, and he showed pictures of the wear of abutment to implant interface is significant.
How much that connection could be opening.
It's kind of enlightening. It could be a problem. Yeah. So if you cheap out like most dentists do, and I'm calling you out right now, because most of you cheap out, you buy the high quality golf balls and you buy the really nice cars, but you don't spend an extra whatever it is
on $50 or something
on the OEM parts. It drives me insane. So, hey, listen.
Yeah. And I think too, I will say now one interesting thing about this study, funding was from ITI.
Yeah.
So, you know, you just have to take that with a grain of salt. Right. Not that I think Cochrane's a shill, because I don't.
Right.
But he does talk a lot about tissue-level implants. And I think, you know, Straumann has a good point.
No, I think they do.
They really do. I mean, they made a good implant. They should brag about it from a standpoint of bone loss, because it's taught us something.
Hey, but they did.
It's taught us what it means to have a one-piece implant, and it gives us something to shoot for, Wes.
Right. So, John.
If we can really make a one-piece implant from a two-piece, then we should be able to rival that Straumann while still having all of the restorative advantages that we get from a bone level.
Let me ask you this question. Some of the newer implants on the market, some of the newer ones that are coming to light, have brought back the external connection for the all-on-4, the all-on-6. You know the company.
Right.
It says right here, based on current available evidence, 1.5 to 2 millimeters of bone loss occurs, here's the word, predictably around bone level external butt joint implants where the interface is contaminated with bacteria.
Yeah.
I'm concerned. And I know that company's working towards a platform shift.
Right. And as long as you know that, okay, I think you can think about that.
How long did it take us to figure that out? We have to study. Well, we have to ask people. You have to go to meetings. Right. You have to figure this out. The thing that I have to say is don't be a jumper. You know, don't be a jumper. Like, oh, here's the next new thing. Go over here. Here's the next new thing. Go over here. John, I've changed implants in 15 years in my hands only 3 times.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I think that how many times have you changed composites?
Right. Not very
often. Not very often.
I mean, I've changed once in a long
time. Once or twice.
Yeah.
That's it. You know?
Yep.
And so here's the thing is like predictability is key. And if we can come away from this study and saying, "Hey, look, don't be a jumper."
Right.
You need to look at your connection, you need to buy good quality parts, you need to consider internal connected implants. Consider them.
Right. And again, have a connection with your or have a discussion on connection with your surgeon.
I agree.
You know, a lot of the people listening to this, they're not implant placers, and that's okay.
That's okay.
You know, we know some people listening to this are, but for those of you who are restorative docs and going, "Well, what does this mean for me?"
I had a surgeon turn me down one time when I walked in and I said, I don't want anything else in my patients. And he said, "Well, I can't place implants for you." And I said, bye-bye. And you know who that is? And guess what? They've came around. And guess what?
Now he understands.
Now he understands.
And don't be afraid to demand that from your surgeons. If restorative
you're crazy. I can't do that. Yes, you can.
Right.
Yes, you can.
You need to ask your surgeon, why are they using the implant that they're using? You need to, again, Send them this article. Yeah.
Send us a comment.
And have that discussion, you know, yeah. And go, hey, what are we going to do on my wife when she loses number 9?
That's a great question.
With this information that we have now, not talking about your everyday patient right now, but what would you do if it was your wife?
Yeah.
And does this change your opinion? If it's your kid, what are you doing here?
Yeah.
So if you can't feel good about that because you're placing a crappy implant, or because you just don't want to change, because my restorative docs don't want to change, so the surgeon's like, oh, I'm just going to do
they don't want to work below the tissue, doctor. They don't want to work down deep. Shut up.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, just get hey, some education.
They don't want to profile their implants, doctor. They don't want to do that, doctor.
Right.
Listen, that's what the surgeons are saying. Listen, they want bone loss. You know why? They get less callbacks because the healing abutments tighten back down. All the
prosthetic impressions.
It's easy to take impressions. I'm calling you out right now. Bone loss is bad.
So if you're better than that, surgeons, or restorative docs, then be willing to step up to the plate and do it right and pick a great implant and make your restoration the hard way sometimes, but do the right thing. If this doesn't change your practice by listening to this, then fly a drone. Yeah, you got it. You got to get. So if you are liking what we're putting down, if you like what we're dropping here, then we want you to go and give us some love. We want you to go to Facebook because, you know, where else are you going to see a show that gets started off with drones, you know, flying across the screen? No, I'm just, but you know, go check us out on Facebook. Go give us a great review on iTunes or Apple Podcasts. Now it's called Apple Podcasts. Give us some of your questions, your feedback. What do you want to know more about? What are you struggling with? What do you think is the best implant? Why are we wrong? Are we wrong?
Please tell me I'm wrong.
Is Brandomark really the best? And it's all just a big conspiracy. Okay, let us know.
That's so
you know,
good.
we want to know. Oh, and man. You know, when we're at Voices of Dentistry, you know, we're going to be giving a pretty controversial talk about some of the stuff that we've been talking about right now.
We're bringing it, John.
We're bringing it, man. We're bringing it. So we're looking forward to giving you guys more of this good information. We encourage you to pick up some journals, find somebody that cares, and sit down with them like we sit down together and talk it out, and don't be afraid to geek out when the time is right. But definitely, we're excited for this next couple of weeks. Tune in to the live stream at Voices Dentistry. Don't forget that. Connect with us. We're excited for what this show is going to be bringing in the next few weeks with some exciting new speakers. And also remember, check out restorativedermanimplants.com for information on upcoming educational opportunities with the Dental Guys. We're going to keep bringing you the quality, Wes, aren't we? Every day, man.
Take it to the next level, baby.
That's right. We are the Dental Guys.